Dr. Seuss has a wonderful story that seems to go well with the message today from the gospel reading. It's the story of the sneeches on the beaches. There were certain people that were called the sneeches, and they were all sort of tall and yellow people with big bellies. Some of the sneeches had stars on their belly, and some of the sneeches had no stars on theirs, as Dr. Seuss would say. And so the ones who had stars on their bellies felt like that they were the superior group, and they acted that way, and they snubbed the ones who had no stars on their bellies. And so it went in their society until one day a character called Sam McBean showed up with a contraption that would put stars on your belly. And for $3, he offered it to any sneech that didn't have a star on their belly, and he had lots of takers. And so then you had a problem that all the sneeches had stars on their bellies, and so the ones who used to have stars couldn't distinguish themselves. So Sam McBean had the solution. His machine would also remove a star from your belly for $10. And so all the ones who started up with stars went through the machine and had their stars removed, so once again they could be the group that didn't have stars this time. And so it went back and forth and back and forth, and they started putting on stars and taking off stars until by the time Sam McBean left that place with everybody's money, nobody could remember who originally had a star and who didn't. And so it was that everyone suddenly became equal in that society. Jesus points us in that direction in our reading this morning from the Gospel according to John in chapter 15, verses 9 through 17. I invite you to listen for what Jesus has to say to us, his friends. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. The word of the Lord for us today. Thanks be to God. In silence, let us pray to the Lord. Amen. Jesus, in our reading this morning, wants us to bear fruit that lasts. And so I started wondering, which fruit lasts longer? A fig on a fig tree or an apple on an apple tree? And then I got to thinking, well, you know, Jesus often speaks in symbolic language, so maybe he's not talking about the difference between fruits like apples and figs and which lasts longest on the vine. Maybe he's talking about fruits that last in the sense of what we think of as legacy gifts or living wills, giving that continues, fruit that lasts even after we are gone. I know the Presbyterian Children's Home and Services has a development officer who works with people to make gifts that last, sustaining gifts. And I know that that ministry bears fruit that lasts. They have been around for more than 100 years, and they have the changed lives to prove that they produce fruit that lasts. The other point that Jesus makes here is about the shift from being a servant to being a friend. Jesus says, "No longer do I call you servants, I call you friends." We tend to think, when we think of God's love and Jesus befriending us, in terms of a pie, you might say, in sort of an old school economic model, we think of one pie, and therefore, if I am Jesus' friend, if God loves me, then that's a little slice out of that pie of God's love. And then if you're God's friend, if you're Jesus' friend, God loves you, that's another little slice out of the pie of God's love. And so we tend to think that the more God chooses people to love, like me and like you and others we know, the less love God has left to go around. Because after all, that's the way we've always understood resources to be. They're limited. But there's another way of looking at that today. We see it in the internet economy through sites like Wikipedia, who use millions and millions of volunteers to create an online encyclopedia that has become so popular that now Encyclopedia Britannica has decided they're no longer going to print encyclopedias. They're just going to focus on their online encyclopedia to try to compete with Wikipedia, which is free. The model of Wikipedia and a lot of these other internet companies say that there's not just one pie. There's millions of pies. And so you can have your own pie. I can have my own pie, and it doesn't take away from anything. It's a model of abundance and that kind of mentality. And I think that's what Jesus is suggesting here. God loves you. Jesus befriends you. Jesus befriends me. But Jesus also befriends others beyond these walls. And we tend to think, well, if Jesus starts befriending too many people, then my slice of God's love, my slice of the pie, is going to get tinier and tinier. But the truth is, there's plenty of God's love to go around. And the more we receive of God's love, and the more we share God's love, the more love there is to go around. We know that we become whatever those who love us think we are. We have a lot of power in that way. Think of it in terms of your mother here on Mother's Day. If your mother thinks you're smart, you probably are, or you're going to become smart. And if your mother thinks you're not smart, it's going to be hard for you to become smart. Because those who we love and those who love us shape our lives. We're going to talk later in this service about an opportunity we have to shape lives, to love others, to hold them up and say, "We believe in you." I'm talking about the Presbyterian Children's Home and Services Project that we're going to talk about. This is an opportunity to provide love and light to people who really need someone to believe in them at this moment in their life. And speaking of mothers, you know, I'm not Mother Teresa. You're not Mother Teresa. We may never make a trip to the streets of Calcutta to reach out to those who are in need. But we have an opportunity to invite those in need to come and to live in our midst so that we can reach out in love. Not to everybody. We can't save everybody, but we can reach out in love to some. One of my family's favorite television series is called The Wonder Years. It's a story about a family growing up in the 1970s and all the adventures and misadventures of the children and their teenage children and so forth. And in this one episode, the teenage boy, the son, is at school, and it's that time in the PE class where they choose teams for basketball. And he is selected to choose a team that day. And he looks around and he sees all his friends. And then he sees all the good basketball players. And those are two different groups. But he decides to do something different because he knows that all his close friends always get picked last for the basketball team. So he decides he's going to go for it, do something different. He picks his best friend first to be on his team, even though his best friend is not any good at basketball. And then the other team captains pick theirs. It comes back to him. He picks another of his good friends who's horrible at basketball, picks him number two to be on his team. And so it goes with all of them picking and choosing until they've gotten their whole team together. And he has a team of his good friends, none of whom are any good at basketball. And of course, when it comes time to play, they get beaten severely in the score, but they have a great time. Because even though they lost the game, which is usual, they didn't get picked last this time, which was unusual. When I think of those friends who weren't good at basketball and who always got picked last, I think also of us, you and me, as friends of Jesus. I think also of those who would be coming in this Presbyterian Children's Home ministry. And I think of the lyrics that Tom Petty sings, "Baby, even the losers get lucky sometimes." Jesus loves us like a friend. He invites us to love others as friends. Even those sneeches on the beaches who originally did not have stars on theirs. On this Mother's Day, a day when we celebrate selfless love, let's remember also the single mothers, the struggling mothers, those who have challenges, hopes, and dreams, just like we do, but maybe not all of the opportunities that we do. They're mothers too. Let's do what we can to support them.